Okay, we're going to start our case discussions. First, I would like to introduce our panel members. As I indicated today, the management of ductal proliferations really require a multidisciplinary approach. And in this multidisciplinary team, medical oncologists, surgeons, and radiologists and pathologists play the most important role. And we have today Dr. Arun, who is the professor of breast medical oncology from MD Anderson Cancer Center. Thank you, Dr. Arun. And we have Dr. El Tamar, who is a breast surgeon from Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center. But he was another panel. Most likely their panel is running late, so he may come a little later. And then we have Dr. Jessica Lang. She is the professor of diagnostic radiology breast imaging at MD Anderson Cancer Center. Thank you very much, Dr. Lang. The first case is a 58-year-old woman who had a stereotactical needle biopsy of right breast, and the calcifications were identified on screening mammogram. And this was a new finding. And this is her core biopsy. And you can see that the microcalcifications are associated with dense stromal fibrosis. But in addition to the area of microcalcifications, we have an epithelial proliferation next to that. And when you look at the intraductal proliferation in high magnification, it is a monotonous epithelial proliferation with well-formed, cribriform areas. And this entire area measures 1 millimeter. And what is your diagnosis? Please, using your audience response system, select one of the four: fibroadenoma with atypical ductal hyperplasia, fibroadenoma with ALH, fibroadenoma with ductal hyperplasia, fibroadenoma with DCIS. There is one correct answer. Please select one. Okay, diagnosis is more than half says it is a fibroadenoma with atypical ductal hyperplasia. There are a few other diagnoses, and number 3 is the second most common, fibroadenoma with ductal hyperplasia, which I will come back to that. And our final diagnosis in our report was number 1, fibroadenoma with atypical hyperplasia, because it is a monotonous cribriform proliferation, and as I indicated, size is 1 millimeter. So this is the monotony that we need to appreciate to make the diagnosis of atypical duct hyperplasia. Under follow-up mammogram, there was our radiologist evaluated the amount of microcalcifications removed. So more than 90% of the calcifications were removed. Patient has a family history of postmenopausal breast carcinoma in her mother and possibly in her paternal grandmother. She had a genetic testing, and she was not found to have any clinically significant mutation. So with that clinical information, now the question is, she has a diagnosis of atypical duct hyperplasia on core needle biopsy. 90% of the calcifications are removed. Does she need excision? Yes or no? By the way, these are all real cases, and these cases were presented in our multidisciplinary conference, and the responses that I am going to give you is the consensus decision in MD Anderson. Okay, more than half, 63% says yes. Number 2, 36% no. The consensus decision in MD Anderson was number 2, no. And we will come back to this after the second case. and we will discuss the management issue of ADH and a corneal biopsy after the second case. But more than 50% of you wanted to excise, and we agreed with the 36%. So case number two is a 52-year-old woman who has a strong family history of breast carcinoma, and she was found to have calcifications associated with density, and she underwent stereotactic corneal biopsy, and you can see the microcalcifications with associated density here. And when we do corneal biopsies, we X-ray the calcifications to make sure that the targeted lesions have been removed. As you can see, that multiple cores have areas of microcalcifications. And this is her corneal biopsy. There are multiple ducts, some of them are dilated, and focally she has an epithelial proliferation, but it is not as extensive as the previous case. In a higher magnification, you can see that microcalcifications are present here, associated with these cribriform proliferation. It is not as extensive as the previous case, but still is a monotonous proliferation with cribriform architecture. High magnification, cribriform architecture. And we also did, on this case, keratin immunohistochemical stain for cytokeratin. And as you can see, the monotonous cells with epithelial proliferation, they are negative. So what is the diagnosis? Columnar cell hyperplasia, adenosis with ductal hyperplasia, atypical duct hyperplasia, ductal carcinoma in situ. Please vote. Okay, we have a wider range of diagnosis on this case. And the most common diagnosis is number two, adenosis with ductal hyperplasia. Number three is adenosis with atypical duct hyperplasia. And 15% would like to call this DCIS. Let's go back to the lesion. Yes, it is a cribriform proliferation, and it is a monotonous cytology. So this is the cytology that we appreciate for both atypical duct hyperplasia and low-grade ductal carcinoma in situ. So here, ductal hyperplasia or hyperplasia without atypia is not in the differential diagnosis because we have a monotonous proliferation. You can think of a columnar cell change in these dilated ducts, but since these dilated ducts do not show any hyperplastic epithelium, so columnar cell hyperplasia is not the correct diagnosis either. And here, these nuclei in screen, it is not showing that well, but the slides are really a lot better. The monotonous cytology makes the diagnosis of ADH versus DCIS. And on the base of extent of the lesion, and here you can say that this monotonous proliferation is not involving the entire duct, it's partially involving. So based on the amount of involvement, the correct diagnosis is atypical duct hyperplasia associated with microcalcifications. In her follow-up, she had more than 90% of the calcifications removed, and she was seen in our high-risk clinic, and she was found to have BRCA2 mutation. So based on this, she has an atypical duct hyperplasia on a corneal biopsy, just like the case number one. Does she need excision? Yes or no? majority, 89%, says yes, and minority says 10% says no. And the consensus in MD Anderson was yes, so we agree with your decision. I wish Dr. Eltemar were here to make the comment. Oh, Dr. Eltemar, you came right on time. Please, to the podium. So, Dr. Eltemar, we are discussing excision of atypical tract hyperplasia diagnosis made on corneal biopsy. I presented two cases. First case is an atypical tract hyperplasia. It's a very focal atypical duct hyperplasia identified incidentally because in this case microcalcifications were associated predominantly with fibroadenoma. So since this is an incidental atypical duct hyperplasia not associated with microcalcification, and more than 90% of the microcalcifications were removed, the recommendation from the MD Anderson panel was not to excise this lesion. In contrast to the second case, which is also a focal atypical duct hyperplasia, but in this case, microcalcifications are associated with atypical duct hyperplasia, and clinically, this is a high-risk patient. So before I ask Dr. Eltemar his recommendations of excision for patients who have an atypical duct hyperplasia on core biopsy, I would like to ask our radiologist, what is the appropriate sampling of microcalcifications identified on mammograph? Yeah, I can hear you.
So one of the criteria for successful core tissue sampling is retrieval of calcifications. And indeed, thank you. The American College of Radiology, in order to be accredited for stereotactic biopsy, needs to show retrieval of calcifications based on specimen radiography. Now, that's only the first step, because it's not just the presence of the calcifications, it's the presence of the calcifications that were representative of the target, number one. So the fact that you have the targeted calcifications. And then the second question is the amount, how much. So what we think is not so much the number, you know, one calcifications versus 10 calcifications, and not even so much the volume of calcifications, let's say 2 millimeters, 4 millimeters, but really how much of the target you have sampled. And what Dr. Sahin showed was the percentage of calcifications we treat. So we kind of came up with a system of, based on the initial target at imaging, less than 50%, 50 to 90, or greater than 90%. And that's kind of an arbitrary device that we have had in collecting data on to see how that works. And so far, I think anecdotally, without looking at all the data so far, it's worked well with us to predict how well you've sampled. And the idea is that if you have greater than 90%, you have really sampled it close to a surgical excision, even though it's not a surgical excision. You believe that or trust that more. And so then, that's all those are important type checkoffs, if you will, before you can say that you did a good biopsy, even if the result is not malignant per se, that you can say no excision needed. Did that answer your question?
Yes. Yes. And then the other issue is that whenever we make the diagnosis and we have this triple test where the radiology, pathology, and clinical findings should really correlate with each other. And as I indicated before, in case number one, microcalcifications were associated with fibroadenoma, so the ADH was an incidental finding. And in case number two, not only there were microcalcifications, but there was also density associated with it. So when we presented this case in our MD Anderson clinical management conference, this was told to be a slight discordance because none of the findings, histologic findings we have in this biopsy really correlates with the density. So one of the main decisions, one of the main factors that made us to decide this patient needs the excision is that mammographic finding.
If I can add that, about that point, is that's what we call RAC-PATH concordance, radiologic, pathologic concordance, or discordance. Or another term for what we like better nowadays is imaging histology concordance or discordance. Because to us, radiographic suggests mammography, x-rays, when it's really the constellation of imaging, including most commonly in clinical practice, ultrasound, as well as breast MR. So let's say that your result matches the mammographic finding, but that the ultrasound finding had indeed shown a mass that corresponds to the so-called density on the mammogram. So that would be discordant with ultrasound, even if it's possibly concordant with the mammographic calcifications. So yes, of course, that's a very important criteria to check off, and also a kind of established known first thing you need to do, and get mandated by the American College of Radiology.
Okay, Dr. Altamar, do you have any comments on this?
Well, I think if you have a pathology by port needle biopsy showing AEH, the standard of care is to excise the area. That is well established. And the reason behind exciting that area is the upstaging associated with the excision. Now, that upstaging rate has dropped throughout history based on the volume of tissue removed through the corneal biopsy. In the old pathology, in the old radiology data where they used multiple corneal biopsy of 14 gauge, the upstage rate was probably in the 40%. However, in the more recent data with using 11 gauge and 9 gauge corneal biopsy, the significant volume of excision, that upstage rate remains in the order of 20%. So our practice has been to remove that area surgically. Now, you're presenting a case, your first case, where you have a fibroadenoma. The question is, why did you go for a corneal biopsy? And then you would say, well, we had a mass, we saw the mass, it looks like a fibroadenoma. But we biopsied, and then you get a fibroadenoma with a tibia.
The first case actually it was a microcalcifications, and on histology it turned out to be fibroadenoma. It was not a mass lesion.
So it was a microcalcification.
Microcalcifications. But microcalcifications are associated with fibroadenoma, not so with a typical ductal hyperplasia, and we interpreted a typical ductal hyperplasia as an incidental finding.
Just associated surrounding the fibroadenoma.
Correct.
So
it's a microscopic fibroadenoma.
So it's a little bit of a difficult, tricky situation. If you want to be a purist, then we will excise that lesion. If you want to individualize that decision for that particular patient, then you may make the case that you just have an incidental finding of ADH and you could watch it. But the general recommendation, and I don't want the audience to leave here thinking that ADH, usually you don't excise it. ADH has to be excised, and that is our standard of care, at least in my center. But in that particular case, you're just finessing it to the best way possible and saying, maybe we could avoid excision, but that's quite of an unusual scenario.
Can I add a comment, too?
Sure.
That is, I agree with the our surgical colleague from New York, because I came to MD Anderson about 6 months ago from San Francisco, and it is absolutely the standard of care to excise ADH. Obviously, there are contraindications, you know, patients 85 years old, or very ill other reasons, and you want to biopsy that patient, but that's another question. But in the typical pattern, the standard of care is to excise. And that our of course, it's obviously important in every case to correlate it as much as possible in a multidisciplinary fashion, is that the standard of care is to excise in majority. And I think Anderson is the different, if you will, and not so much the standard.
Okay. Correct, because as the Dr. Tamales mentioned, in the older series, the upgrade rate was significant, that the automatic recommendation was to excise it. But now we are identifying these lesions earlier and earlier stage, and we are removing most of the lesions, and now actually there's an even trend for low-risk DCIS cases, maybe skipping and reducing the surgery. So it is an area of evolving treatment modalities. So we are, our practice at MD Anderson, we are presenting all these cases in the multidisciplinary conference and make an individualized recommendation. Dr. Arun, between these two patients, there is a significant difference from clinical history and for the BRCA2 testing, the second patient is positive. Is this an important factor for you?
I would say the radiology presentation or the pathologic findings so far from what we know is not important for us. What is important for BRC or considering genetic counseling and testing is the presence or absence of family history. Now, do we see a lot of patients with ADH who have a BRC mutation? We do. But I think we need to point out that these patients, like this one and not the other one, were tested based on family history. And that's because the testing guidelines do not include any ADH or LCAS, and DCIS just made it into the guidelines. So that's why, for example, in the literature, we really don't know the true incidence of BRCA mutations in patients with ADH, because ADH was never the indication for testing alone. So we don't have ADH as a, if you will, a denominator in the studies.
Okay, thank you. So in this first patient, the recommendation was not to excise it, and then this second patient, she had an excision, and the excision showed a lot more areas of proliferative changes, including additional areas of atypical lobular hyperplasia and atypical duct hyperplasia, and she had an excision. So far, these are fairly recent cases. So far, we do not have any additional significant follow-up. Case number three. She's a 65-year-old woman who was found to have extensive suspicious microcalcifications on mammogram. She underwent a stereotactic conoidal biopsy, which revealed ductal carcinoma in situ, and she had a segmental resection. I don't know how well it is shown here, but there are extensive microcalcifications in that region. And this is her histologic sections from the segmental resection. Multiple ducts are containing these cribriform and microcapillary proliferations quite extensively. Microcalcifications are present here, extensive area of DCIS. Microcapillary type, intermediate nuclear grade. There was focal comedonal necrosis and high magnification, intermediate nuclear grade DCIS comedonal necrosis. And this is her int margin of segmental resection. As you can see, she has a DCIS here with some atypical proliferations focally extending to this margin, and higher magnification partially involved DCIS. So is this a positive or negative margin? So is the margin positive, yes or no? One is yes, two is no. I will if I can. I'm sorry, I cannot go back. Can you help me from back? Can I go back to the slide? In order to vote, I cannot go back. One more. here is the margin. Here is the in, and here is the area. Did you decide that you have the margin?
Excuse me?
Have you, so can I move to the next
slide?
Please
go ahead.
Okay. So if the margin is positive, yes. Margin negative, no. Evaluation of margins, both for invasive and in-situ carcinoma, is one of the most difficult and controversial areas of breast pathology. Okay, 76% says yes, 23% says no. And our decision was that actually the area involved by that typical proliferation was partially involved. So we reported as ADH is at the margin as opposed to DCIS. And I will go back to slides and show you why. Here is the DCIS. This is an intermediate grade DCIS. And what we have at the margin is lower grade lesion. So just like anything else in pathology, you always have to compare with your individual lesion. So yes, you may have intermediate to low grade DCIS, but since this was partially involved and it was a lower grade lesion, we said the margin, inked margin is free. And this area over involving over here is ADH is at the margin. So when you receive this diagnosis, Dr. Akhtemar, from your pathology, what is your recommendation? Would you go back and re-excise or not?
So I think this is a very interesting case. And you can't just rely on that pathology report. You have to look into the mammography. And
you
just told me that your mammography shows an extensive microcalcification. And you just showed me that, I think, you know, what I've seen, that the microcalcification are in the DCIS. So the question is, how are you going to follow up this patient, even if you have a negative margin? Would a positive margin make a difference, or a negative margin? She has extensive calcification in the breast. So my feeling is all these calcification has to be removed. It's a problem, but I would feel safer proceeding with a mastectomy with this patient to excise all these calcification. Number one, it has the lowest rate of local recurrence. It may not improve the survival of the patient, but at least this patient will not have to face in the future 50% possibility of that recurrence being an invasive ductal carcinoma. That's the problem with having these extensive calcifications. My radiology colleagues always, you know, cringe when they see this. What are we going to do? How are we going to follow them up? And then we give them radiation, and then they come back 6 months later. Well, we're not sure. There may be a little bit more calcification. So it becomes an issue. I would favor a mastectomy.
Thank you. This is exactly what happened to the patient in Andy Anderson. And this is the reason I put this case is that, you know, when we as a pathologist practice in isolation and he said, well, it's a negative margin, so the